is when one is conscious of the Supreme Personality of God, or when one is Krishna conscious, then he is spiritual. Because when you are conscious of Krishna, then you know who Krishna is, and you know who you are, and you function accordingly. Krishna is great, you are small. You are, Krishna is the Lord, you are His servant, and you are still in the service of Krishna. This is the spiritual consciousness. So in this consciousness, a living entity is situated spiritually. But when a living entity looks away from Krishna, without looking towards Krishna, he looks away from Krishna. Now let us consider to how many directions a living entity can look at. Is there a living entity is a minute or atomic particle, spiritual spark? It is like just one point, it's a ray of consciousness. A ray means just one point. Now, one point can be projected in how many directions at the same time? Only in one direction. So either you look towards Krishna or you look away from Krishna. So when you look away from Krishna, then what do you see? You see Krishna's external energy. It is either Krishna's internal energy or Krishna's external energy. So when you look towards Krishna's external energy, which is inferior by nature, and a living entity is superior. A living entity is superior, and nature, this material nature, is inferior. So when a superior comes in contact with the inferior, what happens? What kind of mentality does he have? Deliverance? He tries to exploit. Because the natural tendency of the superior to dominate over the inferior. So he tries to exploit means he wants to become the Lord and Master. Right? So trying to become the Lord and Master means the false ego. Instead of becoming the servants of the Lord, we want to become the Master of the ego. And that is our false ego, or mistaken identity. False identity. Wrong identity. So, at that point, a living entity once becomes covered by the false ego, becomes affected by false ego. Then, he begins to plan how he is going to enjoy or exploit this. That gives him the second covering of intelligence. And then through his mind, he gets the covering of the mind through which his consciousness constantly runs towards the outside world, trying to enjoy. In this way, he develops a subtle body consisting of false ego, intelligence. And this becomes the cause of his bondage. Just consider, just due to once looking away from Krishna, you got into the miserable material bondage. Just one glance, stuck forever. Therefore, what's the way out of this material bondage? We have to look towards Krishna. And that is the meaning of Krishna. Due to looking towards Maya, we became bound in this way. Now if you look towards Krishna, then you will become Krishna conscious. We will become free from this illusory bondage of this material nature. And the exalted personalities know that. Like the demigods, here you can see, they knew that. They know Krishna. They know the importance of being submissive to Krishna. Now the question is whether they were to act according to that understanding. Most cases demigods don't. And that's the problem. They understand intellectually the importance of becoming Krishna conscious. But they are stuck. Of course, this is also Krishna's arrangement, because if Krishna wants them to perform certain duty, perform certain activities, but he taking care of the universal affairs. That's why to be a human being is better than being a demigod. Because when we get a human body, we actually get an opportunity to free ourselves from the material body by becoming constantly engaged in self-liberation. And then, at the end of this life, we can go back to God. Is it difficult? It's difficult as long as you cannot do it. When you can do it, it's easy. Someone once told me, I told her that French, she was actually helping me to learn French. I said, French is so difficult. She said, no, French is very easy. And then she said, in France even a child speaks French. So, when you can do it, it's easy. When you can't do it, but in order to do it, we must practice. We must practice. Therefore, the initial stage is devotional service. Of different degrees of advancement. Like, you know, there is Adoshraddha, Sadhushanga, Bhajana Kriya, Anathana, Nishtha, Ruchi, Ashakti, Bhav. So, when one becomes a devotee, it doesn't necessarily mean that he immediately becomes the platform of praying and loving state. He gradually advances. And it is said that even from the platform of bhava, one can fall down. But not from the platform of prema. The prema is the ultimate perfection of the meditation.
Still, the body becomes sick, like the six Goswamis.
Oh,
what? Goswami was so much, has so much trouble with his body, which he had now what we were talking about.
But that is different. You see, the body is the external covering. The body is the external covering. And the body may become sick, but the question is whether the personality becomes affected by the sickness of the body.
Yeah, but that would mean that the body is still material because it's a fit in the material conditions.
It is. The body is material. But the thing is, just as iron, it is iron. But when it is in contact with fire, it becomes fire. So when the fire, you take away the fire, then it will become iron again. Or the qualities of iron will be there to some extent. It will act. It is there, it is a substance. So it will function that way. Just like the sickness. Like, you know, you see, pure devotee's condition is that he is completely submissive to the Lord. So he doesn't desire for anything to be in the body. As long as the body has its ability, he renders devotional service. When the body at some point becomes, you know, unusable or useless, then he leaves the body and goes to the body. Not that everybody's body, every pure devotee's body becomes affected or afflicted by the laws of material nature. It may or it may not. It's up to Krishna. The pure devotee just leaves it up to Krishna. Like you gave one example, the body becomes sick. Yes. But there is another condition also, another consideration, like Dhruva Maharaj. For Dhruva Maharaj, the chariot came from the heaven, from the spiritual world. And he got it, when he was about to get into the chariot, he saw that death was standing there with folded hands, kneeling down. Please bestow your mercy upon me. And Dhruva Maharaj put his foot on the death's head to climb the chariot. So here we are seeing another example. Like he is not affected by death at all. And apparently, say for example, pure devotee's condition, like Prabhupada's condition, like first of all, one thing is very noticeable. But he was not affected by the sickness of the body. Like his body is, you know, so sick apparently, but he's still transmitting Srimad Bhagavatam. And look at his consciousness. Look at the 13th chapter of the 12th canto. That Prabhupada did translate, lying on his bed. He didn't even have the strength to pick up the microphone or the head to the hand. Handset. A devotee has to hold it in front of his mouth. And Pradyumna Prabhu, who was from the Sanskrit editor, he used to read the verses in Sanskrit. And Prabhupada would give word for word meaning, the translation, and then he would give the Prabhupada. Is his body material?
No, but that just means that to say that the body is not material doesn't mean it's not under the influence of material nature, because it's an important thing, because many people, especially if they're esoterically influenced, they criticize us and say, you speak of spiritual persons, and we always see them sick.
Well, you may see him sick, but we see him as a pure. Unaffected by apparent sickness. It is up to the individual. Like there is a saying, like, I forgot the first line, it says, you see black, I see white. Like, or you can say the glass is half filled with water. An optimist sees it as half full, and a pessimist sees it as half empty. So it is up to the individual's perception. We can't force it, it's up to you. If you may see that, okay, your devotee is also becoming sick, and it's okay. That shows that the devotional service doesn't work. Okay, if one thinks that way, he is going to miss out on the whole process. And ultimately he is the loser. He is the loser. Whereas on the other hand, a devotee, a person with proper understanding, you know, he sees that, okay, this was just the material side of it. This is what appears to me in my mind. But actually, the personality that he is got affected by that. And through his actions also we are seeing that. Just as, you see, with so much love and care, a devotee worships the Lord in the altar. Now say, if the deities are made of wood, the wood may burn, right? Now, does it stop the deity from being Sachidananda Vigraha? Now how does the devotee see it? The devotee sees that it is my imperfection of my eyes that I am seeing that it is there. The Lord's form is burning or being destroyed. But actually, his form is eternal. Or his form can be broken. Somebody may take the form that is made of clay or even metal. But can the Lord's form be broken? No, his form is Sachidananda Vigraha. But it is due to our defective perception that we are seeing. Now by looking at it that way, do we lose? No. Like for example, you consider somebody who you like, whom you love very much, and his painting is there, his picture is there on the wall. If somebody comes and does something to the picture, how do you feel? Don't you feel affected? Why? It's after all, it's just a picture. So why are you being affected by that? And that is what the not just the external appearance of it. The internal perception is what really matters. Mm-hmm. Yes, Nithyananda Priya Mataji.
I have heard German scientists of religion say that every big, great religion starts with monotheism. Even Hinduism started with monotheism and the conception of time which was linear. Then these religions would degenerate into polytheism, and polytheism is the religion with devas and devis, and they have many, many gods. And then their conception changes into a circular time conception. And I'm not quite sure on which sources they from which sources they just get this information. And what can I tell them?
You can tell them that this is the concept of atheism. Say for example, in your family, you have a grandfather, and then also you have your fathers and uncles and aunts, and then you have your cousins and etc. etc. Now, is it a matter of concept or is it real? Is it that there was one man, your grandfather? And then from that the concept developed that, your fathers and uncles and aunts and so on and so forth. And then it expanded into some other concept and so on and so forth. Is it a concept or is it reality? Your family, is it a concept or a reality? It's reality, right? Now, you see, the Supreme Personality of Godhead and demigod, they are not just a concept that developed out of human, unfertile human brain. It is reality. Krishna is real. The demigods are real. The spiritual sky is real. Krishna's associates are real. Similarly, the material nature also is real. It does manifest and then it does become animate. And that's why I say, because they don't understand, because they don't accept the spiritual reality, that's why they try to theorize it out of their imagination. Right? Now Now, for example, is there any room for a blind man to imagine about the sun? It's a blind man who doesn't see the sun, he will imagine. Oh, actually, some people think that there is some light. After that, it's all dark. But they imagine that there is thing, and they think that it comes up every day in the eastern side at 6 o'clock in the morning and sets in the western side in the evening. A blind man may develop all kinds of concocted theories about that, but those theories doesn't affect a person with eyes. You know, he sees that the sun comes up, so why he theorize the sun? It's real. And with the light of the sun, we see the sun, and with the light of the sun, we see everything else, including ourselves. So similarly, now that you have your eyes, don't worry about what blind people say. Just tell them to open their eyes.
But you see, even the Christian church father, they call the demigods Götzen.
Yes.
Yes. They say that they are demigods and they are Götzen.
They understand. Or don't understand.
They call idols.
Yes.
Idols, yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, they... What to say, I don't know. Well, tell them to read a little more carefully. Read the scriptures a little more carefully and a little more open heart. You see, if a child of a primary school thinks that his books are the ultimate education, then how much he will be his learning? But what does an intelligent student do? He goes from primary school to high school. He's open. Yes, knowledge. There is more and more possibilities of receiving knowledge. So we should be open. We are in primary school. That doesn't mean that throughout my whole life I should be in the primary school. We should get promoted. From lesser information, we should get higher information. So Bhagavad Gita is there. It's not that the Bhagavad Gita is only for the Hindus. Mm-hmm. Bhagavad Gita is for everybody. Every intelligent human being can take advantage. And then we have further information. Srimad Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita. So why those people in the church don't read those books? Why did you ask them? We have some more information which will benefit you. Why don't you study them? If you need some help, I can help you.
You said that in Bhagavatam it was mentioned that there are 3 million demigods. Are they all the titans of heads and of the sunshine? And are they all the devotees?
Okay, the question is, it is said that, I'm correcting you here, that there are 330 million demigods. 33 multiplied by 10. 340 crore. 1 crore is 10 million. So 33 multiplied by 10 is 330 million. So there are 330 million demigods. That indicates that there are 330 million residents in the heaven. And to some extent, they all are controllers. They control in some aspects or others. Just like in a state, everybody is doing something. Everybody may not be the high-ranking government officer. But they're also taking care of some department. Right? So everyone is engaged in that. And you ask whether they all are devotees of Krishna. Not necessarily. not necessarily all demigods, the devotees of Krishna, but they accept Krishna. They know Krishna. They accept. You know, one of the qualifications of being elevated to the heavenly planet is that you have to be a theist. You can't be an atheist and go to heaven. There is no room for the atheist. God's competitors go into the lower planet. Anandu Manjari?
Yes, I wanted to ask if I understood you right. It does mean that for most of material nature, they have no influence anymore on the individual interest of maybe the face of Prema Bhakti and on the face of Prama. And Prama, yes, all the possibility to fall down into the influence on the most of material nature.
You have to say it again, I couldn't get that. Okay, come closer.
The modes of material nature, they have no influence at all when one has attained the stage of Prema Bhakti. So this disturbs and maybe a Shakuna Maya, Mama Maya, Bhakti Maya, and the first one must attain Prema.
Mame Vaji Prakodhan Te Maya Vedan Karuji. Yes. So we have to understand that when one attains the purest, perfected stage, then only he becomes completely free from the influence of material energy. But the other consideration is that when, or rather as long as one remains submissive to the Lord gives him protection. So one may be a neophyte devotee, but if he is submissive to the Lord, he will be protected. Or you can even stretch this concept up to, like, when one is in the material nature, I mean, when one joins the movement, joins ISKCON, lives in the temple, he may be just a new bhakta. Is he protected from Maya? So he doesn't have to be a topmost devotee to be protected. But because he is surrendered to the Lord, and his devotees, he is protected. You see, one falls down only when he gives up the shelter of the Lord and his devotees. Or when one becomes offensive to the devotees, then only one falls down, not others. Okay, I will, last question. You have to come forward. Did you ask me?
No.
Okay.
We all at some point in time in the spiritual world and we fell down. And Krishna promises in the Bhagavad Gita that once you get back to the spiritual world, you can never come back here. I would like to know why is it that we are trying again to get here. Is it possible that when we get back to the spiritual world again, that we can fall down? Of course we have freedom
no,
in the spiritual
you,
world.
You won't, once you go to get back there, you won't fall down. Because once beaten, twice shy.
Yeah, but we have freedom in the spiritual world and we can do whatever
but
we want.
But as I said, once you have seen what a hellish place this is, do you want to come back here again? When you didn't know about this place, then you came here, that's fine. But now that you have seen, now when you go back, do you want to come back again?
So the transmigration of the soul is always in the material world and not in the spiritual world.
Not in the spiritual
world. Once in
no.
the spiritual
world. Right. In the spiritual world, one gets in the spiritual body and that's his permanent body, eternal body. The transmigration takes place only in the material world.
Okay.
Satisfied?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.